Tonight on NewsWatch, between Iran's nuclear program and peace talks with Palestine, 2014 could be a pivotal year for Israel. A look at what lies ahead for the Jewish state. Plus, winter weather threatening millions. We'll show you the areas that could get hit the hardest. And this new year, we'll show you why some bad habits stick and others don't. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Secretary of State John Kerry says peace between Israel and the Palestinians is possible. Good evening. I'm Mark Martin. Secretary Kerry is in Israel today trying to broker peace talks between the two countries. But those negotiations aren't the only issue facing Israel. The nuclear threat of Iran also weighs heavy on the nation. Chris Mitchell has tonight's top story from Jerusalem.
Iranian media reported the Geneva Agreement may be implemented in late January, but the U.S. State Department says a few outstanding issues still need to be resolved. Six world powers in Iran signed that agreement in November. It allows Iran to enrich uranium, but under tighter guidelines. It also eases economic sanctions on Iran. Whenever the agreement is implemented, some, like former Israeli ambassador to the U.N. Dori Gold, believe the Geneva deal is flawed.
What the Iranians want to do is undermine the sanctions as much as possible. So when they go into future negotiations with the U.S. and the P5 plus one in general, there will be no leverage on the American side to extract concessions from Iran.
A bipartisan bill in the U.S. Senate would impose new sanctions if the final agreement allows Iran to enrich uranium. The White House said it would veto the legislation. In addition to Iran, Israel faces major decisions about the ongoing peace negotiations with the Palestinians. U.S. Secretary of State is here in Jerusalem for yet another round of meetings with Israeli and Palestinian leaders. Kerry set an ambitious deadline of late April 2014 to establish a framework for final negotiations. But Palestinian negotiator Saeb Erekat said, if Israel continues building in the biblical lands of Judea and Samaria, known as the West Bank, the negotiations will be over. Erekat's statement follows the release of 26 Palestinian prisoners, most of them convicted murderers. The release, part of Kerry's plan, was celebrated by the Palestinian Authority and upset Israel.
Last night, we saw them celebrating, glorifying terrorists, people responsible for killing innocent civilians, for killing children. This is not the way to start a new year. The Palestinian Authority must stop glorifying murder. It must stop celebrating terrorism.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Former Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon is clinging to life tonight. Doctors say he's in critical condition as his kidneys are shutting down and other major organs are in decline. He's been in a coma since suffering a major stroke in 2006. Sharon is one of Israel's most famous generals, well known for his victories over the Egyptian army in the Sinai Desert during the Six-Day War and the Yom Kippur War. He took a hard line on defending Israel and supporting building Jewish settlements in Palestinian-controlled territory. But near the end of his career, he oversaw the withdrawal of Israeli troops from the Gaza Strip, which is now controlled by Hamas. For more on this, we turn now to our senior editor, John Waggy. John, Sharon is back in the news at a time when John Kerry is pushing hard for a Palestinian state. Do you see a connection there?
I do, Mark. You know, Sharon is a brilliant military general and was one of the most popular prime ministers in Israeli history. But he's also known for not only getting the troops out of Gaza, but 9,000 Jewish residents of Gaza were uprooted from their homes. And Sharon called it a sacrifice for peace that the country had to make. What he didn't get to see because of his coma was the thousands of rockets that rained down on Israel from Gaza after they pulled out. So they didn't get peace for the concession of land. And when we've got John Kerry in the Middle East right now urging Israel to concede more land for promises of peace, Israelis aren't very inclined to go in that direction because they learned the lesson under Sharon that giving up land doesn't lead to peace.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about that. These negotiations between Israel and Palestine, do you see them going anywhere at all?
Well, look, Netanyahu's under a lot of pressure from the United States. There are 160 people in the Pentagon, State Department, and other branches working on the details of this agreement. They want one very badly. But the bottom line foundation's just not there to produce peace. Palestinians are still calling terrorist leaders who were released from prison recently heroes. And these are people who killed innocent Israelis in cold blood, and the Israelis say there's never going to be peace with that kind of thing. There are all kinds of roadblocks on each side. I don't think they're going to go anywhere, but there's a lot of pressure to make it happen.
Let's switch gears a little bit. If Israel determines that Iran is on the verge of building a nuclear bomb, how do you think the Netanyahu government's going to react?
Well, Netanyahu made it very clear in his October speech to the UN that Israel will go it alone if they have to in order to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. So the problem is that the rest of the world does not want Israel to attack Iran to prevent a nuclear weapon. So Netanyahu's got to make an existential decision for his country. I don't think he'll make it unless Israeli intelligence determines without a shadow of a doubt that Israel is going to get a nuclear bomb. Then Israel may be forced to act.
And quickly, do you think we're going to see more violent upheaval in the Middle East?
I think it's almost guaranteed. Now, the question is where. The U.S. pulls out of Afghanistan. Iraq is kind of a basket case. There are 80,000 Hezbollah missiles in Lebanon. Egypt's on the knife's edge. Pick your place. Syria's civil war. There are all kinds of places where we could see an explosion this year in the Middle East. I think we're going to see one. I'm not going to predict where, though.
Yeah, I don't blame you. All right, John, thanks for your insights.
Thanks, Mark.
The Vatican will host a brainstorming workshop to discuss bringing peace to Syria. The workshop is scheduled for January 13th. Experts from the U.S., Russia, and other countries want to figure out how to bring about a ceasefire so humanitarian aid can be delivered. They'll also discuss how to end the persecution of Christians there. Christians are concerned they're being targeted by Islamic extremists who want to oust President Bashar Assad. Negotiations between the Syrian government and opposition leaders are scheduled for January 24th in Geneva. Afghanistan's failure to sign a key security deal poses a threat to that nation and the region. That, according to U.S. officials. Afghan President Hamid Karzai has delayed signing a security agreement with the U.S. That agreement would allow U.S. troops to remain in Afghanistan until 2024. A new intelligence report suggests any gains made by the U.S. and its allies will be lost by 2017. That's because the Taliban and other groups are becoming more influential in Afghanistan. Without a deal, the U.S., all U.S. and NATO forces will withdraw by the end of this year. Here at home, millions from the Midwest to the Northeast are bracing for the first major snowstorm of 2014. The system is bringing with it tons of snow, record low temperatures, and dangerous driving conditions. Caitlin Burke reports.
From the Midwest to the Northeast, people are starting off the new year thinking about snow. Forecasters say 22 states from Kansas to New England are in the path of a massive winter storm.
I just hope that it won't be as bad as they say.
Nearly a foot has already fallen in Chicago, and more is on the way.
I'm not driving today. I'm taking the train.
It just keeps piling up, and it just has not stopped.
It's horrible. I guess it's Chicago weather typical.
Slippery conditions are causing trouble for drivers across the Midwest.
Well, I know people get tired of us saying to slow down, but that's the best thing you can do.
And air travel isn't much better. More than 1,100 flights have been canceled and 2,300 delayed. Now that storm system is moving east. In places like Boston, blizzard-like conditions are expected overnight, bringing as much as 2 feet of snow.
I've been through this before, and I will get through the storm, and Public Works is ready to do their work.
Shelters in Connecticut are gearing up to help the homeless.
There's been instances where people have frozen to death outside, being sleeping on the park benches, and the temperature is just too unbearable for them.
In New York, salt trucks are expected to work 16-hour shifts just to keep up with all the snow predicted. And forecasters warn that behind the snow comes a blast of cold. In some areas, temperatures dropping below zero. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
With a new year comes new laws. Some 40,000 policies have gone into effect in 2014, from limiting drones in Illinois to tighter gun control in Connecticut and California. Most of the new laws are at state and local levels. But one federal law could change the way you light your house. The federal government is now banning the production of all incandescent light bulbs. The move is aimed at promoting more so-called energy-efficient alternatives. It is now legal to buy marijuana for recreational purposes in Colorado. At least 24 pot shops opened in 8 towns on January 1st, with thousands of people flocking to buy the drug. Heather Sells reports.
It is the world's first fully legal marijuana industry. No doctor's note required. And despite freezing temperatures, hundreds of people stood in line Wednesday to test the nation's first legal recreational pot shops.
I've been waiting 42 years for freedom.
Sold my house a couple months ago to prepare to move to Colorado.
We drove 17 hours to get here.
We want to be the Costco of marijuana.
Legalization opponents fear that retail pot will endanger public health. Counselors and physicians say addiction is a serious issue for many young people.
Some people think that marijuana is just psychologically addictive, not physically addictive. It's just a soft drug, something like that. But I can tell you from personal experience that these kids who come to see us are dropping out of life.
Although the legal sales are limited to adults over 21, many fear the drug will be more widely available to teens, lending to greater illegal use. Even though the new rules are underway in Colorado, authorities are warning buyers that bringing marijuana across state lines is against federal law. Colorado's retail experiment is crucial to determine whether pot can be sold like alcohol or whether major modifications are needed. Washington State has also legalized recreational pot and will face the same restrictions when its retail shops start operating in late spring. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Coming up, a look at how one group is attracting kids to the Bible using a new app. Welcome back. The creators of the popular YouVersion Bible app have released a new edition aimed at bringing the Bible to the next generation. The app brings Bible stories alive, Bible stories that is, alive for kids through interactive adventures. It was created with ages 4 through 10 in mind. The app was launched by the international ministry One Hope, which works to reach children across the globe with God's Word. Wendy Griffith recently spoke with one of the pastors who helped create the app. Take a look.
Explain how it works.
We wanted to create a way to help parents engage their children in the broader sort of grand narrative of the Bible. And so we put together an app from the ground up that we designed to really be designed for a 4 to 10-year-old to experience. So it has the ability for kids to hear Bible stories, to read Bible stories, and to also interact with the story. There's various kind of gaming type elements that give them achievements for finding various objects and completing it. But at the end of the day, what we really want them to do is be able to see the bigger story of Scripture and not just individual stories. And so it starts with 6 stories that will grow and expand to 40 in total when we fully finish and complete the app. But we wanted to get it in the hands of people right now so we could begin to get feedback and make it better.
Well, you mentioned you're already getting some great feedback and some testimonies from people and families that have been using the Bible app for kids. Tell us about it.
You know, a lot of the feedback we get ranges from parents saying that they're having to fight their kids to get their phones back, but not because they're playing Minecraft or the latest game, but because they're actually using the Bible app for kids, which is the type of feedback we love to hear. Had a father who mentioned that walked in on his child who was engaging in the story about the cross, and his child was teared up when he was hearing about how Jesus was killed on the cross, and just what that meant to that father, because he's like, I could say that story, I could tell that story, but for his child to be able to experience it in the app was just so incredibly meaningful and powerful for him. And so it's really been a wide range of stories, but the bottom line is that parents are telling us their kids love it and that they're using it, and that's the type of response that we were hoping for, was that we could make it so the Bible is something that kids were really looking forward to learning about, engaging in, and spending time with.
How can folks get the apps?
It's really easy. To get the Bible app for kids, people can simply go to bible.com/kids from any mobile device, smartphone, or tablet, and it will redirect you to the right place to get it. It's completely free. And if you want to get the Bible app, which is designed for adults, you can go to bible.com/app and get that. Both are free, and both will help both parents and children engage in the Bible.
Pastor Bobby Gruenwald, thanks so much for your time. Great to see you.
Thank you.
Yeah, important idea there. In other news, the Boy Scouts of America are kicking off their new policy allowing openly gay scouts. The organization made that decision last May, but it just took effect in the new year. The ban on gay adult leaders remains intact. Meanwhile, Christians unsettled by the new policy are offering two alternatives. Trail Life USA is just getting started with 425 troops pre-chartered. The Royal Rangers program is another alternative. The Assemblies of God has offered that option for more than 50 years. Up next, CBN News looks at how people can work to break bad habits. If you're like most people, you have some unintentional bad habits. A Duke University study shows nearly half of everything we do each day is not a conscious decision, just something we do by habit. But as our health reporter Lori Johnson tells us in tonight's Focus Report, there's a new technique that can help us take control of our behavior.
Most of us know from experience bad habits such as smoking and eating junk food are hard to break. And good habits like that New Year's resolution to exercise every day are hard to keep. But you're more likely to succeed with a new strategy. Scientists recently uncovered an enormous amount about how habits work in our brains.
Everything we know about the science of habits indicates that any habit can be changed.
In his book, The Power of Habit, Charles Duhigg points out each habit contains three parts. First, a cue, which automatically triggers us to start. Then comes the routine, which is the behavior itself, followed by the reward, which is what we crave and is the key to our brain remembering that routine in the future.
And everyone from, you know, Aristotle to Oprah talks about changing habits. And for years, they focused on the routine, on the behavior. But what we've learned is that it's really the cues and the rewards that shape how habits function. And that's how you can change habits, by diagnosing and paying attention to these cues and rewards.
Charles used himself as an example. In his job at the New York Times, he wanted to break his bad habit of eating a cookie in the company cafeteria every afternoon. So that's the routine. First, he identified the cue, which is always one of five things: time of day, a certain place, presence of other people, a particular emotion, or something you just did.
And so every day when I had a cookie urge, I would write down those five things. You know, where am I sitting? What am I doing? And I realized pretty soon that the cue was a certain time of day. It always hit between 3:15 and 3:45.
Then he experimented to diagnose the reward. Did it satisfy hunger? No, because after eating a filling apple, he still craved a cookie. Was it getting a break from work? No, because after walking outside, he still craved a cookie. How about interacting with other people? Bingo, because when he socialized, even without food, he felt content.
The cookie had essentially become an excuse for talking to other people. So once I recognized that, once I knew that the cue was a certain time of day and the reward was the social experience, I could reshape the behavior, the routine. So now every day I stand up at about 3:30 and I look for someone to go have a conversation with, and I walk over to their desk and then I go back to my desk. And the cookie urge is totally gone. I've changed that habit.
Let's say you want to break your habit of smoking a cigarette every night, and you figured out your cue is finishing dinner and your reward is feeling relaxed. Now you need to find a better routine that delivers the same reward, such as taking a bath. But what if instead of changing a habit, you'd like to start a brand new one, like daily exercise? In this case, you have to come up with your own cues and rewards, but make sure the reward is something you genuinely enjoy, like listening to your favorite music.
If you go for a run every morning and you tell yourself, I'm going to reward myself by eating kale chips, that is not going to work because nobody actually likes kale chips, right? On the other hand, there was a study that was done in Germany where they told people, go running in the morning, start an exercise routine, and when you get back to your house, eat a small piece of chocolate. Now, this is counterintuitive, right? Because nobody exercises to eat more chocolate. And yet it worked. Because chocolate is a reward that people actually enjoy.
So by understanding our habits are simply cues followed by a routine, then a reward, we can control our behavior. And as a bonus, the longer we stick with a habit, the easier it becomes.
Great advice for the new year. Well, up next, bringing in the new year with a plunge. See the brave volunteers who took a dip in a frigid river for a good cause. For some, the best way to ring in the new year is with an icy cold swim. Not me. People from around the world gathered in Pennsylvania to take a dip in the Susquehanna River for this year's Penguin Plunge. Swimmers ranging in age from 8 to 80 braved the cold temperatures, all for the sake of charity. Volunteers who took the plunge raised thousands of dollars for the Humane Society. The money goes toward finding homes for hundreds of animals in need. Plungers who brave the elements say, even though it's cold, the good cause makes it worth it.
The river will jump in the lake, but first we have to break the ice.
It's for a good cause, and I don't really care if I get cold.
I do it because I love animals, and I'm not old enough to volunteer at the Humane Society, so this is a good way for me to help out.
This is 15-year-old Devin's fifth plunge. She has raised over $20,000 over the years. She says she's looking forward to helping animals find a home. Well, good cause, but I don't think I'd want to do that. That's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. Hope you'll join us next time. Happy New Year.